Okay. So somatic motor pathways, you see the arrow from the brain to the muscles. Okay. So somatic motor or somatomotor descending pathways, you can see two types or two ways, two routes. One is direct or pyramidal tracts, direct pathways or pyramidal tracts. Okay. More other we can call more apt towards is pyramidal tracts. Okay. Pyramidal tracts and extra pyramidal tracts. So these pyramidal tracts, they are direct pathways. They originate. Their origin is or the cells are in the brain or in the cerebral cortex itself, like the motor cortex, premotor area and motor area or frontal eye field, such motor areas or motor cortex of the cerebral cortex and towards the spinal cord or towards any nuclei in the brainstem. Okay, so they are called as direct pathways or pyramidal tract. Indirect pathways, their origin is in the nuclei below the cortex, subcortical nuclei. Okay, like red nuclei or like nuclei in the midbrain or nuclei in the pons, nuclei in the reticular activating system, such nuclei. Okay, not directly from the motor cortex of the cerebral cortex. It is from some nuclei in the subcortical region or in the brainstem. Okay, more apt brainstem, nuclei in the brainstem towards the lower region of the body or towards the spinal cord or towards the skeletal muscles of the body. Okay, so and there are some confusions in direct and indirect pathways. You can see some of the textbooks, the pyramidal tracts itself, the pyramidal, there is only two division, like pyramidal tract and extra pyramidal tract. And in the pyramidal tract, they have given as direct and indirect, like there is a crossing over is there, some of the fibers crosses, and that crossing fibers are indirect and uncrossed fibers are direct, like that division is seen. But I have referred like another reference textbooks of physiology. I've seen this is a more apt word, like direct pathways, they originate directly from the cerebral cortex, the cells in the cerebral cortex, and indirect pathways, they originate the cells in the brainstem or nuclei in the brainstem. Okay, and now we'll see in pyramidal tracts. Pyramidal tract, they form pyramid-like structure in the medulla. While passing through the medulla, they form some bulge out. Okay, bulge out, which looks which is called as pyramid of the medulla. And the cells also, pyramidal cells, they arise from the pyramidal cells also. Okay, so these are the pyramidal tracts. Are two tracts are there in pyramidal tract, two type of tract. One is corticospinal tract and the other one is corticobulbar or corticonuclear tract. Okay, corticospinal tract, it arises from the cortex, or the origin is in the cortex and ending in the anterior gray horn. Okay, anterior gray horn of the spinal cord, and then the upper motor neuron, anterior gray horn of the spinal cord. For corticobulbar tract, origin is in the cortex, in the cerebral cortex, but end is in the nuclei of different cranial nerves. Okay, nuclei of different cranial nerves. Okay, so that is the difference in corticospinal and corticobulbar. Origin is both the tract, or they arise from the cerebral cortex, the premotor area and motor area, primary motor area or frontal eye field, all these areas. And corticospinal ends in the anterior gray horn of the spinal tract, spinal cord. Corticobulbar, they end, their termination is in the nuclei of different cranial nerves. An indirect pathway, as we have seen, many are there. They originate in different nuclei in the brainstem. Okay, they many nuclei are there, clusters, okay, masses of the cell bodies. They originate there and then ends up in different segments, sections of the spinal cord. Okay, accordingly. Sometimes they end up in the nuclei of the brainstem as well. Okay. So here, Okay, this is an ascending descending tracts, it is shown. And here you can see upper motor, this is a direct pathway. Okay, corticobulbar and corticospinal, direct pathways. They originate from the brains, from the cerebral cortex towards the towards the nuclei of these cranial nerves and towards the skeletal muscles or towards the spinal cord. And these red colors are the indirect pathways. Okay, indirect pathways, they originate from different nuclei. Okay, different nuclei of the brainstem or subcortical regions. Okay, so you don't get confused. If you see in the textbook also, this is, I have referred and I've given like this. More wrapped division is this one, direct and indirect pathway, means a pyramidal and extra pyramidal pathway is also otherwise called as direct and indirect pathway. In some of the textbook you can see the pyramidal pathway itself is divided into direct and indirect. Okay, so their concept is different. So here, okay, so we'll deal about direct pathways now. Okay, so indirect pathways, I told corticospinal and corticobulbar. And we'll see first the corticospinal. Okay, so this is the corticospinal tract. In corticospinal, they arise from the motor cortex, more precisely if we say motor area number 4, we have already discussed about areas in Brodmann's area, the area number 4, okay, the motor area and the premotor area, area number 6. Or as well as from the frontal eye field, okay, the frontal region, frontal eye field, that is the number is 8, okay, area number 8. So area number 4, 6 and 8, primary motor area 4, premotor area 6 and the frontal eye field 8. So from these areas, these cells or these neurons arises. And you have seen in somatic sensory pathway or ascending pathway, you have seen three sets of neurons, a primary first order neuron, a second order neuron and a third order neuron. Okay, three sets of neurons were there. And for a motor tract or for a corticospinal tract, we have two sets of neurons. And we don't call them as primary or secondary or first order, second order. We call them UMN and LMN, upper motor neurons, UMN. See, you can see here, upper motor neurons. And then we call them lower motor neurons, okay, LMN. So here the upper motor neuron, and here the relay is very less, only one synapse happens here. Okay, so the upper motor neuron axons are very long. They extend from the cerebral cortex all the way from the cerebral cortex till the spinal cord segment, where they synapse with the lower motor neurons. Okay, so it travels all the way from the brain towards the lower regions, even the lower region, lumbar segments of the spinal cord section. Okay, so here they arise. This is the origin of the upper motor neuron. Okay, so upper motor nerves, and then they leave there the cortex, and that is also called as corona radiata. Okay, they leave as corona radiated, like radiating fibers. And then they descend down through internal capsule. And this internal capsules are bundles of axons, like tracts inside the brain. Okay, tracts inside the brain. So we told already nerves outside the brain, we call them the bundles of axons as nerves. And inside we call them as tracts. So these internal capsule is a white matter actually, okay, tract. Myelinated axon. So they run via that internal capsule, then reaches the midbrain, lower regions, next level they reach midbrain, pons and medulla. Okay, pons and medulla. So medulla, you can see they form bulgings of the medulla, and that is called as pyramid of the medulla. Okay, so in the lower region of the medulla, okay, when they reach medulla, the lower part of the medulla, the lower part of the medulla, 90%, you can say 80 to 90%, okay, of the fibers of these bundle, okay, they together, they come as a bundle. And then at the lower part of the medulla, in that bundle, in that one bundle, 80 to 90%, they cross over to the opposite side. Okay, they cross over to the opposite side. Okay, and then enters into the lateral white column. Lateral white column of the spinal cord of the opposite side. Okay, opposite side. And this crossing over, anywhere crossing over is called as decussation. Okay, decussation. Decussation. So decussation of the fibers happens. Okay, and they enter into the lateral white column. And from there, they go to the anterior. So always we have seen the gray matter of the spinal cord has three regions, posterior gray horn, anterior gray horn, and lateral gray horn. Okay. So posterior, they have sensory nuclei of the sensory neurons. And in the posterior, in the anterior, we have nuclei of the somatic motor neuron. Okay. And lateral, we have nuclei of the autonomic motor neuron. So here, after entering into the lateral white column, these upper motor neurons, they go to the anterior gray horn, nuclei in the anterior gray horn. So that is the termination, nuclei in the anterior gray horn, with the help of interneurons or without, directly also. Okay, so then from there, the lower motor neurons, see, this is the lower motor, they are very shorter, they are very close to the effector organs. Okay, so suppose if it is to the lower limbs, this upper motor neurons descend down to the sacral segments or lumbar segments, okay, L2 segments. And if it is to the upper limbs, they end up in cervical segments. Okay, so like that. So from there, the second order, here we call them as lower motor neurons. They make synapse with the lower motor neurons and then supply to the skeletal muscle. And I told here decussation happens only 80-90%, and the rest of the nerves, the fibers, they descend through the same side and enters the anterior white column of the spinal cord. Okay, of the terminating spinal section of the spinal cord. And after entering into the anterior white column, they cross. There they cross to the opposite side. The decussation happens at the level of spinal cord. Okay, after entering into the anterior white column, and then they enter into the anterior gray horn of the opposite side of the spinal cord segment, and then make synapse with the lower motor neuron, and the lower motor neuron supplies to the muscle. And this track, this one, which crosses over to the opposite side at the level of decussation, happens at the level of medulla and enter into the lateral white column, is called as lateral corticospinal tract. Okay, lateral corticospinal tract. And the one which does not cross at the level of medulla but descends to the spinal cord to the anterior white column and then crosses the opposite side, this tract is called as anterior corticospinal tract. Okay, lateral corticospinal and anterior corticospinal tract. So in pyramidal tract, we have corticospinal tract and corticobulbar or corticonuclear tracts. And in corticospinal tract, we have lateral and anterior corticospinal tract. But these two tracts, they take origin from the same cells or same area, and at the level of medulla, 80-90% crosses to the opposite side at the level of medulla, and those are and enter into the anterior white column of the spinal cord segment and called as lateral corticospinal tract. Okay, and here those who does not cross to the opposite side, they descend through the anterior white column of the spinal cords, and then after reaching the termination segment, they cross to the opposite side and supplies to the lower motor neuron, and those tracts are called as anterior corticospinal tract. Okay, and we have two sets of neuron here, an upper motor neuron which carries the motor command from the motor cortex directly from the cerebral cortex all the way till the spinal cord segment, and lower motor neuron which makes synapse with the upper motor neuron and supplies to the effector muscle. Okay, only two sets of neuron. And we'll see, this is the separate lateral corticospinal. At the level of medulla, they decussate. Okay, crossover is called as decussation. and ends in the lateral white column, and then synapse with the enter into the anterior gray horn, make synapse with the lower motor neuron. This is the anterior spinothalamic, descends through anterior white column of the spinal cord without crossing at the level of medulla, and then make synapse with the second order with the lower motor neuron at the level of their termination. Okay, so we'll see the corticobulbar. Corticobulbar is same. They originate from, you can see here, it is a frontal epiphyseal region. They originate from the cerebral cortex itself, but they end up in the upper motor neuron originate from the cerebral cortex, and the upper motor neuron end or terminates in the nuclei of different cranial nerves. Here you can see facial nerve, this one. Okay, they end up in the facial nerve, the same side and also opposite side. And here it ends up, this is in the hypoglossal nerve, okay, nuclei of the hypoglossal nerve. And like that, they end up in oculomotor, trochlear, trigeminal, abducens, facial already, facial glossopharyngeal, vagus, accessory, and hypoglossal. Okay, all these nuclei of cranial nerve nuclei, they end up and then supply to the muscles. And here, this corticobulbar, they supply to the skeletal muscles of face. Okay, face. For the facial expression. Okay. And here, this I forgot to tell, here, this one, this lateral, okay, lateral corticospinal tract, they supply to the distal parts of the limbs, where which helps you to do this, the sophisticated movements like playing piano, or you button up your shirt, or something like sophisticated or skilled movements of the distal, like a finger and your toes, extremities, okay, extremities. And this one, anterior corticospinal, they supply to the trunks and proximal parts of the where you don't need, where you need a mass movement, not a precise, sophisticated movement. Okay. Who is making tea there? I can listen to some cup sounds. Okay. So, indirect pathways. We'll see indirect pathways. Okay, so indirect pathways, pathways I told, like they originate from nuclei in the brainstem and subcortical regions. Okay, and this is a consolidated. We have a rubrospinal, reticulospinal, medial longitudinal spinal, rectospinal, vestibulospinal tracts. Okay, so we'll see their functions also under each heading itself. So this is the in short form we have given. So we'll see first rubrospinal. So this arises from red nucleus in the midbrain. Okay, red nucleus in the midbrain, they crosses to the opposite side, and then descends down, and then ends in anterior motor neuron, like same like anterior gray horn of the spinal cord, and then makes synapse with the lower motor neuron. Okay, and their function is to facilitate the muscle tone, or they maintain the muscle tone by influencing the flexor muscles. Okay, they have a facilitatory influence upon the flexor muscle tone. Their function is to maintain the muscle tone. The muscle tone is already given by the motor commands of the corticospinal tracts, but this helps to maintain that muscle tone by having a facilitatory action on the flexor muscles. Okay, so this arises from the red nucleus in the midbrain. And here you have reticulospinal. This you can see, you see the red and blue lines here. So this arises from the reticular nuclei, okay, reticular formation of the pons, in the pons and in the medulla. Okay, they arise from the reticular formation of pons and medulla. And here they have, this have only uncrossed fibers, pontine fibers. Medullary, a very few, okay, very few or negligible, they are crossing to the opposite side. and they also terminate in the neurons of anterior greyhound. Here you can see termination, there is no change in the termination. The motor neuron nuclei are situated in the anterior greyhound of the spinal cord. Okay, so all the upper motor neurons, they terminate in the anterior greyhound of the spinal cord if it is towards the spinal cord. You have seen the corticobulbar, they end up in cranial nuclei. Okay, so here then in the anterior greyhound, they make synapse with the lower motor neurons. And here the functions are, the general function is control of voluntary movements and muscle tone, and also respiratory muscles and diameter of the blood vessel. But these two fibers, pontine and medullary fibers, have opposite effects on these functions. Okay, the main function is to control the voluntary, coordinate voluntary movement, control muscle tone, and then control respiration, but have opposite. Okay, we'll see which are those opposite effects. See here, the control of voluntary and reflex movements, while pontine reticular fibers helps them, facilitate them, medullary fibers inhibit them. Okay. And the muscle tone is facilitated by pontine fibers but inhibited by medullary fibers. And while pontine fibers favor expiration, these medullary fibers favor inspiration. And on the blood vessel, the pontine reticular fiber causes vasoconstriction. Meanwhile, this medullary reticular fibers, they cause vasodilation. Okay, so we have in reticulospinal, we have medullary reticulospinal tract and pontine reticulospinal tract. Okay, because they arise from two different nuclei in the reticular activating system or reticular formation, in the pontine nuclei and also from the medullary nuclei. Okay, and they have a common function. Commonly, they do the same function. They regulate voluntary movement. They control muscle tone. But effect is, action is opposite to each other for pontine and medullary fibers. And here, this is, you can see this eye picture. And so this medial longitudinal fasciculus or this tract, it is mainly to help the reflex movements, coordinate the reflex movements of the head and neck in accordance with the pupillary, with the ocular reflex, ocular movements, okay, in accordance with the movement of the eye. Okay, in accordance with the movement of the eye or visual impulses, you will have to move your head and neck. So that is coordinated by this medial longitudinal fasciculus. So it takes origin from different areas like vestibular nuclei, because you need to, vestibular apparatus is to regulate your equilibrium or posture, and reticular formation for the consciousness, okay, or wakefulness. Superior colliculus, which is a center for visual reflexes, and interstitial cells, kajal. Okay, so these four, from these four nuclei, they arise and then they terminate in the anterior motor neurons of the spinal cord at different segments. Okay, and so they regulate your reflex, the muscles, regulate the muscles in accordance with the reflex actions, accordingly with the visual reflex. Okay. And now comes tectospinal. So you have learned in sensory pathway spinotectal. So it is like, it is tecto, means it arises from the midbrain. Okay. We have seen the tectum of the midbrain, where we have different nuclei. So what is superior colliculus? Okay. Superior colliculus. So it arises from the, here you see the superior colliculus of the midbrain. Okay. So, and then cross the midline, this crosses the midline and then terminate in the anterior motor neurons of the spinal cord. Okay. Then from there, lower motor neuron extend to different segments of the spinal cord, I mean muscles. And this also responsible for the movement of head in response to visual and auditory stimuli, since it arises from the superior colliculus. You can see here also, fibers arises from the superior colliculus. So superior colliculus is the center which is responsible for the reflexes, visual reflexes. Okay. Ocular reflexes, more precisely ocular reflexes. Okay. And vestibulospinal, it arises from the vestibular nuclei. Two types, medial vestibular nuclei and lateral vestibular nuclei. Okay. So, and these two origin forms two different tract as well, anterior vestibular, or it's also called as medial vestibulospinal tract and lateral vestibulospinal tract. So these takes origin from the medial and lateral vestibular nuclei or vestibular gang. This is outside. Okay, here vestibular nuclei, and then descends down. And then anterior vestibulospinal runs down from medulla into the anterior column of the spinal cord, and all the fibers are uncrossed. Lateral fibers descend through the lateral column, and very few crosses opposite side before descending, and then they terminate in the anterior gray horn of the anterior nuclei, in the gray horn, anterior gray horn, and then connects with the lower motor neuron. Okay, so upper motor neurons and lower motor neuron. And since it is originating from the vestibular nucleus, okay, vestibular nucleus, it is controlling your equilibrium. Okay, concerned with the adjustment of the position of the head and body while linear or angular acceleration. Like suppose when you rotate, okay, and also if you are in the lift, okay, that is linear acceleration. So such, during such movements, angular or linear acceleration, your head and body should be, the position should be adjusted to maintain the posture and equilibrium. So that is done by the vestibular nuclei or this vestibulospinal tract. So wherever you see the vestibular nuclei, the role is to maintain your equilibrium, balance, okay, posture and balance. And then comes olivospinal. It is like not so important one. It's a minor tract. It starts from the, here you see, inferior olivary nucleus. Okay. And this is involved in the reflex movements arising from proprioceptors. Along with the other tracts, it regulates the reflex movements. And we'll see the lesions. You have seen two sets of neurons, upper and lower motor neurons. So in both cases, lesion means destruction. If upper or motor lower motor neuron, if they are destructed, one common symptom is you lose your voluntary movements. And to differentiate between whether it is upper and whether it is lower, mostly in upper motor neurons, the paralysis will be spastic paralysis. Okay, rigidity. Okay, muscle tone increases and rigid type of paralysis. And exaggerated deep reflexes, you can see ankle and patellar clonus. I told continuous contraction. And superficial reflexes are lost and Babinski sign become positive. This is another important symptom of an upper motor neuron lesion. The Babinski sign become positive. That is fanning of the toes. Okay, up dorsiflexion of the great toe and other toes, they fan. They like they extend. Okay, fanning. Normally, it should curl down. All the toes should curl down. So, this become positive in case of upper motor neuron, and there will be spastic paralysis. And in case of lower motor neuron, the same. You lose all your voluntary movements, but it is a type of flaccid paralysis. No tone of the muscles. No muscle tone will be there in this case. So, which is called as flaccid paralysis. In case of poliomyelitis, because poliomyelitis, those poliovirus, they attack the anterior gray horn of the spinal cord. They reside in the anterior gray horn of the spinal cord where the lower motor neuron originates. Okay, where the upper motor neuron makes synapse with the lower motor neuron. So those polioviruses, they attack on the lower motor neurons. So which causes, in case of polio, usually you can see a flaccid type paralysis. Both cases, there will be paralysis. In one case, upper motor neuron, mostly it is spastic, and lower motor neuron, it is flaccid type. Okay, and same absence of superficial and deep reflexes in affected segments. And if it is towards the lower limbs, those muscles get atrophied. Okay, atrophy of the or wasting of the muscles supplied by the affected nerve. So these are the upper and motor, the other spinal cord lesions, and we have already discussed, like spinal shocks and all. So here today we have discussed about pyramidal tracts and extra pyramidal tracts. So pyramidal tracts, we have seen corticospinal tracts and corticobulbar tracts. And corticospinal tracts, we have seen lateral corticospinal tract and anterior corticospinal tract, and both originates in the same area, premotor, primary motor, motor and frontal eye field, like area number 4, 6 and 8. And then they have seen, according to the entry, decussation and entry of the white column, they have been divided into lateral and anterior. Lateral supplies to the distal muscles for more precise movements, while anterior supplies to the trunk muscles and proximal part of the limb muscles for the mass movements and the tone of the muscle tone. And we have seen corticobulbar, which ends up in different nuclei of the cranial nerves and regulates the movement of the facial muscles, okay, and tongue, facial muscles and tongue. Most of the facial muscles, motor movements of the facial muscles. And we have seen indirect pathways. Indirect pathways originate, indirect or extrapyramidal. Okay, extrapyramidal. They originate, takes origin from different nuclei in the brainstem and subcortical region. And they are rubrospinal, reticulospinal, medial longitudinal fasciculus, tectospinal and vestibulospinal. Rubrospinal arise from red nucleus and involved in the facilitation of flexor muscle tone. Reticulospinal arises from the pontine reticular fibers and medullary reticular centers and is involved in the regulation of voluntary movements, control of muscle tone and respiration and diameter of the blood vessel, having opposite actions each other. Okay. And medial longitudinal fasciculus arises from different nuclei in the brainstem, but they have a common function to coordinate the reflex ocular movements and integrate the ocular and neck movements. Okay, your ocular muscles, eye muscles, and neck movement are integrated by this tract. Fasciculus means bundles or tract. And tectospinal originate from the superior colliculus in the midbrain and helps in the movement of the head in response to visual and auditory stimuli. Vestibulospinal arises from the vestibular nuclei in the medulla. They are like medial and lateral vestibular nuclei, and they regulate or they are responsible for the adjustment of the position of head and body during angular and linear acceleration. Okay. And then olivospinal, which is responsible, which helps in reflex movements and arises from the inferior olivary nucleus in the medulla here, inferior olivary nucleus. And we have seen also the lesions. Okay, different upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron. Upper motor neuron, Babinski sign positive and observe spastic paralysis. And lower motor neuron, flaccid paralysis are observed and also atrophy of the muscles. Okay, so this is about motor pathways. And after finishing posture and equilibrium, we'll discuss about the questions, how to answer it. And see, and again, this these tracks are very important. You have to, what you call, refresh today itself or next moment itself, read it, and drawing aspect, diagrams are very important. Okay, without diagram, no CNS answers. In the CNS, you need to explain with the help of diagram. Okay, and this while studying also, without drawing and drawing the diagram and studying, you won't remember it. Okay, so all the nucleus sections or structures, all those things you have to draw and then study, and for the exam also. Okay, so hope. Okay, so shall we end? And only 2 minutes left. So tomorrow we'll deal with posture and equilibrium. So we will have to deal more about vestibular apparatus. Okay. Okay, thank you. So ending the meeting.